Friends, we will continue with our previous discussion and look at the example 4. For the assessment year 2006 and 7, assessing officer disallowed an expense of P under 143(3) by his order dated 31/12/2008. Commission of Income Tax appeals by his order under section 250 dated 30/10/2010 allowed this particular expense, and later on what has happened is Supreme Court disallowed this particular expense. Unlike the previous example where it is the Commission of Income Tax appeal disallowed and Supreme Court allowed it, now reverse situation is Supreme Court disallowed it subsequently. As a result of that, what will happen? Naturally, the order becomes mistake, so it need to get rectified under section 154 to see that Supreme Court decision equally applies in this particular case. So now, can it be possible? Now the Commission of Income Tax appeals will sue moto or an application made by the assessing officer to him invoke the provisions of section 154 and disallow the expense of P on the basis of Supreme Court judgment. What we say, the Commission of Income Tax can pass it the rectification order, can pass the rectification order under section 154 up to 31/3/2015, because to carrying out the rectification of mistake, 4 years time period is there. So when the Commission of Income Tax passed the order 30/10/2010, so 31/3/2011, say 4 years means 31/3/2015 that they can make the rectifications. So point here is rectification is possible, but can he bring 147 into play? Because for doing 147, what is the time limit for issuing the notice is there? That is 2 years and all. So since that 2 years time has been elapsed, what we say in this case, reassessment under section 147 is not possible as per the proviso to section 147, because issue P has gone in for an appeal before the Commission of Income Tax. So in respect to the matters which are being referred to the Commission of Income Tax, such matters cannot be taken up for the reassessments. See, here the only possibility that the department has got is to carry out the rectification is possible. But in case if a particular matter is being brought before the Income Tax Commission of Income Tax appeals, the same matter again, in respect of that particular matter, the assessing officer cannot take up 147. So here, as far as the student's knowledge with respect to whether rectification is possible under section 154 is one aspect. Second aspect is sometimes they may complicate the question by saying that can this issue be taken for 147. See here what has happened, that is assessing officer disallowed it and SC has gone for an appeal for it, and the Commission of Income Tax appeals disallowed it, Commission of Income Tax has appeals has allowed it, and subsequently Supreme Court has disallowed it. Now the point here is a department need to make that particular income taxable. What is the course of action it has got is only to invoke the 154. It cannot invoke the 147. 147 is only in a situation where income has escaped the assessment. Already this matter is well before the department, because department disallowed and Commission of Income Tax appeals upheld the departmental view, and Commission of Income Tax accepted for SSC's contention, and Supreme Court disallowed that particular expenditure in a similar situation. So there your 147 is not possible. So please make note of this knowledge point. Reassessment under section 147. Reassessment under section 147 is not possible. Is not possible in respect of issue that has gone in for an appeal,
before the Commissioner of Income Tax that has gone in for appeal before the Commissioner of Income Tax appeals. Now, friends, I move to the amendment brought by the Finance Act of 2012 in the area of settlement commission. Of course, we are not discussing the total income tax with respect to the settlement commission, only amendment part. If I look at application to the settlement commission, generally what will happen? There is an undisclosed income, search proceedings got initiated. Then if the SC voluntarily want to offer that particular income and what he want to offer and pay the tax is as per the requirements there, he can go and take the shelter with the settlement commission. Settlement commission is not for you and me. Only when a big amount of tax can be offered, then we can take the shelter of the settlement commission. Now, what is the issue here? Section 245C dealing with application for settlement of cases has been amended with effect from 1-7-2012. Before this amendment, an application can be filed before the settlement commission under section 245C by a related person who has a substantial interest of more than 20% of the profits of the business at any time during the previous year. But now they said, no, it is not possible for the related person to file, to make an application to the settlement commission. Necessarily, he must have the substantial interest at the time when the, what is it, that particular structure takes place is a point. So, this is a small amendment. So, please make note of it. Section 245C. Application can be filed before Section 245C. An application can be filed before settlement commission under section 245C, under section 245C by a related person who has a substantial interest on the date of the search, underline on the date of the search. See, earlier what it is, friends, at any time during the previous year. Now what we say, at the date of the search is a point. Then 245, next, authority for advance ruling. What we say, what is the kind of amendment that is being brought in the authority for advance ruling? See, from 1-4-2000, with effect from 1-4-2013, not 11 and 12, this is prospectively 1-4-2013, assessment year 2013 and 14, by this amendment it is provided that SC can approach authority for advance ruling for determination of a decision whether an arrangement which is proposed to be undertaken by a person, resident or non-resident, is an impermissible arrangement as provided in section 95-102. Try to understand the point here is, there is a body called as authority for advance ruling. If a non-resident gets any doubt with respect to a transaction which he is going to do, whether it is a taxable in India, and in case if it is taxable in India, what is the tax implications, to know that an application can be made before you enter into a transaction. All these facilities are being given by the Income Tax Act for the simple reason we want to not to harass the people. So you first find out and then you take a, what is it, knowledge based judgment. So here, what is the point? This will enable such kind of AAR, authority for advance ruling, will enable a person who is entering into an arrangement to get in an advance ruling from authority for advance ruling. If he apprehends that assessing officer may invoke GAAR provisions during the assessment proceedings. Of course, we will take a separate session on GAAR. anti-avoidance. As suggested earlier, this provision should be made available to the person entering into specified domestic transactions under section 92 BA. See, point here is reference. See, now it is not only the non-residents and the transactions are entering by the non-residents. Even that is now we wanted to see that even with respect to the specified domestic transactions, can a reference or can we make an application with AIR for it to tell us in advance what is the status of the Indian income tax law with respect to such a transactions. Can we do so? Yes. So, take the point here. What is the amendment? Write down. It is provided that an SSC can approach authority for advance ruling for determination or a decision whether an arrangement which is proposed to be undertaken by any person is permissible arrangement as provided in section 95 to 102. And one more small amendment is 245Q, fees for filing the application with advance rulings. Earlier it used to be 2500, now application filing fees is 10,000. Write down section 245Q, fees for filing application for advance ruling. Is increased from ₹2,500 to ₹10,000. Then friends, we have some more amendments. These amendments are with what are the issues which can be appealable before the Commissioner of Income Tax Appeals, and what are the issues which you can make an appeal before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. See, earlier also I told one thing, appeal is not a natural right. Only when it is being provided by the law, only those situations are appealable is a point. So they have brought some more things through the amendment that these things can be appealable before the Commissioner of Income Tax Appeals. I don't advise you to write, but just remember it. See, we have already discussed this. A tax deductor can file an appeal on or after 17-2012 against an intimation issued under section 200A. Already we have discussed that. If in the intimation, if there is any mistake, and since that intimation is a deemed demand notice under section 156, so such can be very well be appealed before the Commissioner of Income Tax Appeals. Similarly, the SC can file an appeal against an order passed by the SCing officer under section 153A in such cases, if such order is not passed in pursuance of the directions of the DRP, dispute resolution panel, this will be effective from 1/10/2009. Similarly, if the SCing officer has referred the matter to transfer pricing officer and enhanced the income and the SSE updated for that, then the SCing officer referred the matter to DRP and the DRP accepted the viewpoint of the SSE, then the SCing officer is not giving effect to the what DRP is saying, then always an appeal can be made by the SSE to the your Commission of Income Tax Appeals. Similarly, the SC can file an appeal against the order of the assessment or reassessment passed under the new section of 92 CD2 after furnishing the modified return based on the advance pricing agreements. Of course, friends, I will also take up in the next session the advance pricing agreements and GAAR and non-resident taxation and transfer pricing. But that session is planned on Monday. Next, penalty order passed under section 271AAB where such has been initiated. Even this penalty order also is appealable before the Commission of Income Tax Appeals. Now, I move to the next thing is what are the appealable things which are being added to the existing list of appealable things before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal is appointed. See, the following amendment has been made with effect from 1/4/2013. Any order passed by the assessing officer under section 143.3 or 147 or 153A or 153A, 153C in pursuance of an order passed by the Commissioner of Income Tax under 144BA in accordance with the directions of approving panel or the CIT. So, in order to give a direction, in order to follow the direction given by the Commission of Income Tax or the Dispute Resolution Panel, if an order is passed by the assessing officer, such orders are appealable before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. Then the following amendments are made with reference to the DRP cases. See, point here is you can't go to Commission of Income Tax Appeals in respect to the matters where a similar or same status authority or the higher status authority passed orders. So, Commission of Income Tax has ordered the assessing officer to or given certain directions in respect of a particular assessment. Such orders of the assessing officer can be only be appealed before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. That is dispute resolution panel cases. Based on the dispute resolution panel direction, if the assessment gets completed by the assessing officer, such assessments can also be appealed before only the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, not before the Commission of Income Tax Appeals. How many places an SSE can cry? First, you should have the clarity. First, he can cry with a regular assessing officer asking him to rectify it. If he don't do that, then the next crying is with Commission of Income Tax Appeals. Then the next crying is with the ITAT. Then if your case involves the issue of law, then you can take up your case with the High Court and the Supreme Court. These are the places where you can go and make a cry. That is appeal. Now, friends, the assessing officer or the SC is entitled to file a memorandum of cross objections on the receipt of notice that an appeal has been filed by the other party. Because with Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, both SSE as well as assessing officer both can make an appeal to the ITAT. But only thing is, if SSE files an appeal, then department has to file memorandum of cross objections. If a department files it, the SC has to file the memorandum of cross objections. Any order passed under section 153A or 153C in pursuance of a direction of the DRP, all these things can be appealed before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal only. Now, 292CC, authorization and assessment in case of search and requisition. A new section is being inserted. What is this new section says? Procedure for authorization of the assessment in certain cases of of search or requisition. See, in one particular case, Allahabad, the CID versus Srimati Vandana Verma, it was held that if search warrant is in the name of more than one person, then assessment cannot be made individually in the absence of the search warrant in the individual name. Possibility and probability is there that this type of sections can come in the CA final exam. This is a new section 292 CC. See, we are carrying out search. There we found undisclosed income. And now it involves undisclosed income of four people. Is it that search warrant is to be issued on each of them to complete the assessment? Is one such warrant is enough? Is the basically the point there. So what we said is, to overcome the judgment which says that in the absence of the search warrant you can't take up that 153, so please make note of it, that is section 292 CC. Section 292 CC, where a search warrant has been issued, where a search warrant has been issued mentioning the names of more than one person, the assessment oblique reassessment can be made separately in the name of each person, can be made in the name of each person mentioned in such search warrant. Again, you can well understand what is my point with an example on the PowerPoint. That is, take the example. Look at, Commissioner of Income Tax issues search warrant on 10-10-2012 for conducting a search. In the search warrant, the names of Mr. Ahmed, Shakil, Kumar and Mr. Johnny are mentioned together. The four are business associates. In search, unaccounted cash and jewelry is found as under Ahmed 50 crores, Shakil 20 crores, Kumar 10 crores, Johnny 16 crores. Assessing officer makes the assessment under section 153A for the assessment year 2007 and 8 to the assessment year 2012 and 13 on the four persons individually. SC contends that assessment under section 153A should have been made on AOP, Association of Persons of these four persons, and challenges the assessment. Now, in view of section 292 CC, the assessments made under section 153A by the assessing officer are correct. Now, I move to the amendments in the area of appeals. Again and again, if some point is coming in our discussion, definitely take it for granted. That will also come in your examination paper. Intimation after processing the TDS statement, is it an appealable situation? Yes. If there is a mistake in an intimation, then earlier it is not appealable kind of situation because intimation was not an order. But with the amendment now being made, it is stated that intimation after processing of the TDS statement is an appealable one. Please make note. Intimation after processing of the TDS statement. Intimation after processing the TDS statement means a return statement, appealable. Then next issue, just have a look at, so that for remembering these things you can write side things. A sitting officer may file an appeal against the order passed by him in pursuance of the direction of the dispute resolution panel. See, directions given by the dispute resolution panel are always binding on the assessing officer. So, point here is, he will give effect to those directions, but he is still permitted to go to ITAT against the directions given by the DRP. Right? See, iska ye matlab nahi, DRP jo directions diye, that are binding on the assessing officer. Now, assessing officer cannot challenge these directions before the ITAT. Very well, he can do it. So, it has been provided that assessing officer may also file an appeal before the ITAT against the order passed in pursuance of the directions of the DRP. Please make note of, assessing officer may file an appeal. Assessing officer may file an appeal against the orders passed by him, against the orders passed by him in pursuance of directions of dispute resolution panel before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. And one more amendment. These are all consequential amendments. Orders passed under 92 CD are appealable to the Commissioner of Appeals. Write down. Orders passed under section 92 CD shall be appealable to CIT appeals. Last, of course, you need not write this. Appeal against the order passed by the assessing officer with the prior approval of the commissioner as referred to in section 144BA. See, if the order is passed by the assessing officer with prior approval of the commissioner, then such is not appealable before the Commissioner of Income Tax Appeals. It shall be appealable only before the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal only. So, as a thumb rule, please do remember, in case of an order is passed by the assessing officer, based on the guidance direction of the Commissioner of Income Tax regular, then such orders cannot be appealed before the CIT appeals. They are necessarily to be appealed before the much bigger authority than the commissioner level, that is second appellate authority, that is commissioner, that is Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. With that, I completed the major part of your assessment procedures, and the attached procedure is what? Penalty procedure. So, penalties, I have got about 7 to 8 penalties which I have to discuss with you, and I will take up immediately after this. Nana in cup of